Public Relations Student Society of America. I would like to welcome you all this evening to our fall panel, Media and Law Enforcement, a Complicated and Critical Relationship. I would like to thank our panelists who have come near and far to be with us this evening to discuss this very important topic. In light of everything that has taken place in our nation in the past year and a half, with law enforcement constantly being in the media, we wanted to discuss this very important issue. At this time, I would like to invite Dr. Anthony Perrineau, chairperson of the Department of Journalism and Public Relations and advisor for the Public Relations Student Society of America.
Thank you. I just want to take a moment to acknowledge Lauren and her tremendous efforts in putting this evening's event together in the Department of Journalism and Public Relations at Edinboro University. We feel we're no better or worse than the performance of our student organizations. And so from our PRSSA chapter to ETV, WFSE, The Spectator, who collectively represent Edinboro campus media, on behalf of our faculty, I say we're very proud of all of those student leaders, and Lauren's efforts certainly are indicative of that tonight. It's my pleasure to be here to introduce you to this truly distinguished panel of experts on this very important topic. I'm going to break a rule of mine, and people who know me are going to like it, because I'm actually going to read short scripted introductions, because my more personal ones can run a little long, and we have a short time frame and an important topic and a lot of people we want to hear from, so we're going to get right to it. I'm going to start on my far right with Craig Holler, who has served as a state prosecutor in the Crawford County District Attorney's Office in Meadville and also as a federal prosecutor in Montana. Since 2007, he served as a federal prosecutor in the U.S. Attorney's Office in Pittsburgh, where he's been assigned to the violent crime and child exploitation sections. Holler is currently the lead prosecutor for the Organized Crime and Drug Enforcement Task Force program in Western Pennsylvania, a member of the Executive Committee of the National Association of Assistant United States Attorneys. He is participating as a representative of that organization and in his personal capacity, not as a representative of the Department of Justice. I deliberately introduced Craig first because I think that final disclaimer, I think we should automatically pass that on to all of our panelists. We understand they're here to share their informed and educated expertise and their opinions, and so we will not assume necessarily that their opinions represent an official opinion of any of their law enforcement agencies or news organizations. And I ask you to please hold your applause until I get to the end. So thank you for that also. Next to Craig is Emily Mattson. Emily has worked as a producer, reporter, and anchor at WICU-TV, where she serves as the station's crime reporter. She's won numerous awards, including a Pennsylvania Association of Broadcasters Award for her Officer of the Month series, which is a collaborative effort with the Erie County District Attorney's Office to recognize outstanding police officers in Erie County. Emily also serves our department as a volunteer. She works with our campus media organizations who now work collectively to push content to the EdinboroNow.com website, and Emily has been an invaluable professional assistant in making that happen. Next to Emily is George Stevens. George is a 24-year veteran of the Montgomery County, Maryland Police Department, where he serves as field training officer coordinator and a senior advisor for the Police Explorer program. He has received numerous awards and recognitions for his service, including a Lifetime Achievement Award from the Drug Abuse Resistance Education of America. Now moving to the other side of the podium, on my immediate left is Dan Lane. Dan has been an officer with the Gaithersburg, Maryland Police Department since 2004, and for the last 7 years, he's served as their public information officer. He also works as a drug abuse resistance educator, teaching programs at middle schools in the Gaithersburg area. Next to Dan is Doug Oathout, who is the executive editor of the Erie Times News. He's been with the Erie Times News since 1995, first as a health writer in the lifestyles department. He became an assigning editor in 1998, was promoted to assistant managing editor of news in 2008, then promoted to editor of news in 2014, and he's held the current organization's top spot in the newsroom since February. Doug's organization, the Erie Times News, also works with us. For the last 2 years, they've been a co-sponsor of our Digital Media Academy, which is an outreach program for high school students in the area. On the other side of Doug is an Edinboro University faculty member named Elvidge Murphy. And Elvidge has been a faculty member in the Department of Political Science and Criminal Justice since 2002. He served as their department chairperson from 2012 to 14. He's a former Erie County Assistant District Attorney and Assistant Public Defender, and currently maintains a private law practice in Erie. I want to thank Elvidge individually for participating in this event, and I want to thank his department collectively, the Department of Political Science and Criminal Justice, because they've been so supportive of us putting this event on. We had an idea, and they allowed us to run with it and backed it up. But I want to make it clear it's a joint effort. You know, at Edinboro University, they do law enforcement and criminal justice. We do journalism and public relations. So in addition to thanking Elvidge individually, I again want to thank that entire department for their support of this event. One more acknowledgement I have to make before I get to our final panelist, and that is also to welcome the Pennsylvania Cable Network. PCN actually made the trip up from their bureau in Pittsburgh to cover this. They're streaming it live on their website as we speak, which I think most of our media students might describe as a pretty cool thing. We're happy to have them here because it gives obvious additional exposure to our university and department, but more importantly, it brings this very important discussion to potentially more than 3 million households across the state of Pennsylvania. So I welcome also PCN to Compton Hall and the Edinboro University campus. And my final introduction is going to be to turn this over to the gentleman who's going to take it from here and close it out. His name is Lou Baxter. He's the news director for Jet 24, Fox 66, and UrieErie.com. He's been in that position since 2004, but he's actually often described as one of the original members of the Jet News team. He began his broadcasting career more than 40 years ago in Erie at WWYN Radio, later worked at WQLN-FM and WRIE Radio before joining Jet as part of that original team in 1980. Like George and Elvidge, Lou is a graduate of Edinboro University. He serves our department as a member of our professional advisory board, and his news organization is a co-sponsor of our High School Journalism Day and competition, which we hold each spring. So now, why don't you cut loose with a little applause for all our panelists and welcome Lou Baxter.
Well, good evening, everyone. It's great to see you all. Thanks for coming out, and it's great to be back at Edinboro University and Compton Hall. Back in the day, this was a gymnasium years ago, and we didn't have a beautiful color HD television studio over there. We had something black and white in the corner of the building that had cameras about the size of a small automobile. But anyhow, we are here tonight to discuss the news media and law enforcement and the complicated and critical relationship that these two organizations have. Both of them serve the public, and yet we do it in different ways. And tonight, we're just going to have sort of a free-flowing discussion of various issues, And we want that discussion at some point to also include you. I have given the green light to our panelists that at any point during the discussion, if they have a question, they can feel free to raise their hand and ask it. And then late in our time together, we're going to give you the opportunity to do the same thing. So while we may not hit on all of the things that might interest you or you'd like to know about, we are going to have time to be able to give you an opportunity to ask those questions. And now that you've had some introductions, what I thought we would do is begin by exploring in a little bit more detail about what each of our panelists here do in their day-to-day routine in their professions, but more importantly, as that applies to interacting with either the news media or law enforcement, because we all do that in different ways based on where they come from. So maybe we start down here with Craig, and as a prosecutor for the federal government, talk to us a little bit about what you do and your involvement and relationship with the news media.
Well, what I do day-to-day is prosecute criminal cases, and we prosecute large drug trafficking organizations, higher level, I think, criminal cases than perhaps are prosecuted in state court at times, but certainly state court prosecutes significant criminal cases as well. It's a good title for this program that it's the complicated and critical relationship between the law enforcement and the media, because, I mean, realistically, the relationship that I personally have as a line in the courtroom prosecutor in federal court with the media is I really don't have one. We don't do interviews. I'm not permitted to really speak with the media. But I recognize the necessity of there being a relationship and that there is some flow of information there. Because we need the media. We need, I think, the public to know what we do on a day-to-day basis. I think to some degree, because we aren't able to reveal what we do, there's probably more public distrust in thinking that we're kind of hiding the ball and doing something underhanded, and I can tell you that we're not. We're not doing sort of searches and seizures without legal justification and things of that nature. But I think there's some sort of misunderstandings out there, maybe because we don't share enough information with the media, and as a result, people think we're kind of hiding something when I do not believe we are. So that's...
And if I could explore that with you just a moment, because we know in some situations where we're dealing with, prosecutors' offices and so forth, that some assistant DAs and those that are in the office are able to speak to the media, but it is fairly common that we don't hear from prosecutors very often, but we do hear from the U.S. attorney, who is everybody's boss in your office. And so what do you think the reasoning is behind that person being the designated spokesperson for the office versus those that are actually working on individual cases?
Well, I think that, number one, I think the U.S. attorney is more equipped to speak on, important public issues than we are. A lot of times the information I would have to share are things that really is not public information. It's more related specifically to what cases I'm working on, and I don't think that it would be, it's not really fair for me to reveal information about my cases that I haven't revealed to the defendant in my cases or to the defense attorney. I think that there's certainly a level of concern there that I don't want to prejudice the defendant or the defense attorney by revealing information publicly before we actually have the trial and things like that. I also think that a lot of what we do and how we do it is dictated by Department of Justice policy. And I'm not being critical of that policy. It's just there is, in fact, a policy in place. There's the Privacy Act that we have to live by. And as a result, I think we probably share much less information at the federal level than is shared at the state level. And that probably leads to more suspicion about what we do because we don't share as much information about what we do.
Is there a sense of wariness of the news media in an office like yours?
I think there is, but I think it's more wariness that as sort of a line prosecutor of getting in trouble for talking to the media than there is about what the media would actually do with the information if we did provide it.
Gotcha. Emily, let's talk about what you do in your relationship with law enforcement.
Okay. I am a reporter with WICU and WSE. I've been with WICU for 12 years, 10 years as a reporter. I'm a general assignment reporter, but I'm focused on the crime beat. So for the past 10 years, I've worked with or I've covered several different stories over the years, several different, hundreds of different law enforcement stories or related stories throughout the year. I enjoy it. I think it's important. I have an important job to let the community know what's going on in their neighborhoods and how they can make their neighborhood safer. I have a good rapport with our local police departments, district attorney, and I think we have a good working relationship. Sometimes we, of course, run into our challenges, but all in all, it's a fairly good relationship.
Do you find wariness on the part of police agencies, prosecutors in the district attorney's office, or, you know, obviously in the federal government? Again, they're not permitted to speak, but what's your hurdle in terms of dealing, you know, with those agencies?
Yeah. Well, I think locally, any relationship, it's all about trust. And I think locally I've built a lot of trust over the years with officers. We were talking earlier, you know, if sometimes we may hold information or get stuff off the record, or if I'm at a scene and I get video of a drug bust, they might say, hey, you know, we're looking for the bigger fish in the pond here. Can you hold off on this? And then I have to determine, is this worth running this story? Is this worth going with it? Probably not in the grand scheme of things. No one's in danger. So just over the years, you get that relationship with the officers you're working with. So they can give us information. What I run into the other day, there was a story where I had to call Harrisburg for something. And that person told me, off the record, I can't tell you anything. I'm like, that's not off-the-record information. Usually off-the-record information is, you know, followed by some sort of tidbit of information that I can go on and dig up something with. But he doesn't know me from, you know, anybody else. You know, I might burn him. I might release off-the-record information. So it's more of a challenge when I'm dealing with people that I don't know and getting information.
Well, if you worked in Montgomery County and needed information from the police department there, you'd be talking to George here. So, George, tell us a little bit about what you do and how you interface and relate with the news media.
Well, I do a lot of things in my career, but first and foremost, I'm dad to Lauren, Ian, and Aaron. That's my primary function. Once I turn over that function, I am actually in charge of the Police Explorer program where I teach high school students. I introduce them to law enforcement. More importantly, I teach them life skills, how to become productive citizens, how to interact in society in a positive way. I'm also in charge of the field training program for our department, which means after our police recruits, after they finish their first phase at the academy, they go into their second phase where they're being trained by an officer on the street. So I'm in charge of that program where we educate them on how to be a good and productive street officer, how to deal with the public, how to go about their job in a daily manner in a safe way. How it interacts with the media is, it was already said, it's about trust, respect, and how that relationship is built and maintained. So I try to teach people in anything, those are your focal points, and especially with the media, because it's crucial, because I think if you don't have that, it could go either way. It could go really bad or it could work really well. And when it works really bad, it makes for a really long day for everybody. Because I think no matter who it is, all of us on this panel has the same thing and that we want done, that the safety and the welfare and the protection of our community and citizens and each other.
And in your department, are you the person that interfaces directly with the media? Are you generally the spokesperson for incidents and the department and what's going on?
I am not. We actually have a PIO office, okay. And our officer does that. I do a lot of things. A lot of it comes through because I'm so involved in the youth and the community. A lot of it comes, those issues come through me. And when it pertains to field training, those issues come from me.
And I would let you know, because he didn't, that a lot of his expertise that he's gained to do what he does now was learned right here.
Right here.
As a resident assistant for many semesters at Edinboro University. So thanks, George. Okay, Dan, let's talk about what it is you do and how you interact on a regular basis with the news media.
So for my department, I have actually two jobs. I am the department's public information officer, where I work with media, sharing information that obviously they want to know. They have my cell phone, they have my email, so 24/7 they get a hold of me. I also serve as the department's community services officer, where I serve as liaison between the community and the department. So concerns and issues that a lot of the neighborhoods have that they're seeing are voiced to my office, and then we find a way to resolve it. The benefit to that is, because Gaithersburg is in Montgomery County, which is 30 minutes outside of D.C., a lot of the NBC4, Fox 5, WJLA News, a lot of their members live in Montgomery County. So some of them do live in the city where I work. So I do have a relationship with them, not only on the media side, but as a community officer. So a lot of their concerns that they address, they may not voice on the media at all because it's so small, like Ms. Emily said, about, you know, small fish in a big pond. A lot of them look at it as, okay, do I want to, you know, a parking issue or a drug house issue, is this something that would be worthy of it, or is this something I just share with the police, you guys resolve it, and I know you're doing your job. Because of that, you know, we have built a huge trust with them, where we meet with them, you know, once a year. With all the new media outlets, we do a meeting in the office. They get to know who I am. I get to know them. I get to know where they live, and they live in the city. They try to get a little bit more attention from me, asking for things. But, you know, daily I'm communicating with everybody and anybody, and I think both the community and the media share the same kind of role with each other.
And in your community, are you generally the first person contacted by the media if and when there's an incident?
Unfortunately, yes. Does not make a difference if I'm up here or if I'm about 2 weeks ago, I was taking a trip somewhere and got phone calls from media inquiring about, you know, some issues. So generally, they'll email me first. If they can't get a hold of me, they text me. If they don't text me, then they call me directly. If they don't do that, then they call my office and request that, hey, look, transfer me to a cell phone, which they normally do. And so, but I'm primarily their person. Yep.
Okay. Doug, Erie Times News. Talk to me about what it is that you do or your staff does and how it interrelates with the law enforcement.
Well, my job at the Erie Times News is to oversee 53-member news operation, four members of whom, no matter what, at a minimum every day deal quite frequently with guys like Dan. It is their job to reach out, not just to the Erie Police and State Police, but to all the small police departments to find out what's going on. Every morning and every evening shift begins with a series of calls to upwards of 45 different departments. You know, and they're calling all across, you know, the region. And it's entertaining to hear the reporters starting to make that call, and they're making that contact. But that's not all they do. They're going out to, you know, crime scenes, fire scenes. They're in the courthouse because as part of our job is we cover crime, the entire arc of the incident from when it happens to when it's resolved at sentencing. And, you know, and along that way, you're having a series of contacts with not just the officers involved, but their bosses, the prosecutors, defense attorneys, the judges, the people involved themselves. And, you know, along the way, you know, things can go sideways in relationships, but generally, if you have a strong relationship between the reporter and the officers, yeah, you're going to have a good report each day.
Okay, thank you. And Elvidge, how about you in your vast, or, you know, array of experience? Talk to us about what you've done and really how you've related with the media?
Well, I can just tell you, my relationship with the media, we've lived in, you know, and I always say we because this has been a partnership between my wife and I. You know, we've really made Erie our home, and we've dedicated our life and service to everything to really have a significant and a positive impact on the people here. And when I listened to Attorney Haller and talking about the restrictions that he has to operate under as a federal prosecutor, it sort of reminds me, my former boss, the former Erie County District Attorney and now current colleague, Dr. Joseph Conte, you know, he always wanted his assistant DAs to have the opportunity to get out in front of the camera and to have an opportunity to really share and explain certain things that were taking place legally within our community and how it had an impact. You know, but he was always careful to make sure, and this is what I've always admired about Dr. Conte, he always modeled what he preached. And oftentimes you got to be careful. You know, not so much paranoid, but you want to exercise an appropriate degree of responsibility when dealing with the media, because prosecutors have an ethical obligation especially in Pennsylvania, under the Code Professional Rules of Responsibility, that under Rule 3.8, we have to be careful about what we say to the media about any case that we're involved in, because any extrajudicial statement can materially prejudice the outcome of a case. And then when I began doing criminal defense work, I began to learn and realize that there are ways in which the media can be a benefit when you're representing a defendant. And very simply, you want to get a message out because you understand the people who are listening to that message. And this is very simply a strategy and tactic. You understand that they are a part of a prospective jury pool. And if there are things that there are things as a defense attorney that you can do, and you can work very closely with the media. There are certainly members of the media that I have grown close to here in Erie County, one of which is no longer with us. She died some time ago. But there's a very small contingent of media personnel that I've always found, you know, I've always been able to trust. Not so much that, you know, when they need me, I can be there for them, and when I need them, they can be there for me. But now, being in the academic world for 14 years, you know, I find myself now that relationship has been more of a consultant. Oftentimes, media personnel, not just locally, but nationally, oftentimes they find out about your background, your experience, and they want the benefit. They want you to give them some insight when things occur locally, when they occur nationally. You know, I've had the privilege of working on a number of special commissions for the county as well as for current Mayor Joseph Sennett. And oftentimes those findings in that work, it puts you in a position where the media wants to be able to understand your findings. They want to be able to understand your analysis so that they can accurately report it to the general public who's going to be impacted by that work. You know, so, you know, my relationship with the media has really undergone just an incredible evolution. And now that I have, you know, backed away from the private practice of law and now running a foundation with individuals in the community, we're looking to try to spearhead, you know, collaborative efforts to work closely with law enforcement to make a significant impact on trying to reduce the occurrence of crime, especially crime involving our children. And certainly, it's very important to have that kind of connection and to continue and to maintain those relationships, because you want people to understand the vision of exactly what you are attempting to do and who's involved in it.
Well, now that we've set the table and you have a better understanding of, A, who they are, and, B, what they do, let's move into, you know, what we in the news business, I guess, would call the lead story here. And I would be remiss if we didn't begin our discussion tonight with what is all over the news as we sit here tonight, and that's the tragic shooting on a college campus in Oregon, where at last report 10 people were dead and 20 people were injured, and the shooter has been killed. And you know, those are the kinds of incidents that so intimately involve the news media and law enforcement. And I guess I don't know where to begin, but maybe, Dan, I'll begin with you. Talk to me, when something like that happens, I can tell you, you know, the news media is there, they're setting up their live trucks, they're reporting hardly before the smoke clears, and they are searching desperately for information, and you're likely one of those people that gets a call right away in an incident like that. But talk to me about, you know, what you do when a tragedy like that happens, when there's an active shooter situation or any other major incident.
So I'll get two calls. One will be from the sergeant on duty, who will tell me, hey, if you're listening to the radio, listen to it, here's what's going on. The second call comes in from media saying, tell me what you know. Generally, my response is, stand by, I'll get back to you in a minute. I've still got to figure out what's going on myself. So what we end up doing is patrol officers will set up an area called the media staging spot. That's where we put all media personnel. They will stay somewhere safe out of the zone where they're not going to get hurt, and where they're not going to be in the way of what's going on in the action. At that point, I then meet up with our command staff on point there and discuss, okay, what can I share? What's not going to be in the way? What's not going to hurt the investigation? And what's going to get as much information as we can possibly out to the community? At that point, then, we'll sit down with a lot of the members. They put their cameras right in my face. 16 microphones show up. And I basically give them the information of, on such and such date and time, we received a call for shots fired or an active threat. And then I give them as much detail as I possibly can. We don't try to hold back anything. The only things we will probably most likely hold back is obviously what kind of injuries there are, because at that time you don't know what the injuries are. You'll say they're non-life-threatening at the moment, or you know, at this time we have a number of injuries, but we're not certain how many. So we'll go from there, and then we'll share with them, you know, where we're at, what's going on, what agencies are involved. With something like this, an active threat, we're going to have multiple agencies showing up. There's going to be state agencies, your county agencies, and your local cities. We're going to have a powwow with the fire department. We're going to have powwows with city attorneys, city elected officials, because they want to know what's going on. Along with the school, we're going to sit down and discuss it with your school administration, because we're going to have to know where we're going and what's going to happen where. We're going to assign somebody else to look for social media. I knew about the Oregon shooting very little. I don't know as much as other than what we've seen on the news. But if anybody's here familiar with Howard County, Maryland, mm-hmm. Okay. Howard County had a shooting last year in March at the mall. The job that we did out there that the Howard County Police Public Information did was awesome in regards to a lot of you guys use social media and Twitter. They were immediately having someone assigned to a Twitter account and started giving information that way. They went from, you know, I'm just giving a spitball number. They went from like 1,000 followers to 5,000 followers in a matter of seconds. During that time, they addressed a lot of what was going on. Hey, here's what we have. Here's where the shooters are. This is what we're hearing. If you're inside the mall, lock yourself down. Don't move. Stay right there. Call the police where you're at, and we're going to get to you. And then when media outlets were reporting, this is what they had, the public information was tweeting back saying, whoa, that's not what we're confirming, that's not what we're saying, here's the actual information. With social media, it is a double-edged sword. We all want to get the information out there quickly, we want to share with what we can, but at the same time, as we on the police department side, we have to vet it. We can't just give you what you want right away, because I don't want to mislead you with anything. But that's what I would be assuming right now that we're doing at Oregon is we're all trying to, someone's doing social media, looking for hashtags, looking for trending information. You've got me who's talking to the media. You've got another person who's like my job, sitting with the command staff in a big bus, drawn on a board, what can be done.
And I would think, you know, asking Emily and or Doug here, sometimes that information just doesn't seem like it's coming fast enough. So what do you do about that, and what do you do in the meantime while you're waiting for official information to be released to keep your readers, your online readers, or in this case, viewers? You want to start now?
Oh, sure. I guess you brought up a good point about social media. With social media, everything is now. But you have to, as a journalist, get the information first. So there's a point, too, where we have to step back and say, you know, our producer's calling us saying, what's going on? Where, you know, I have to tweet this. Tell me what, you know, what do I put on Facebook? What do I get out there? And it's like, you got a deep breath. I, you know, I'm get your information. So me, I come from old school and new school, kind of. I want to get the information out there first and quick on social media. But I also want to make sure it's factual, too. There have been times when stuff is put out on Facebook and it's incorrect. And it goes against what a lot of journalists believe in, is the, you know, getting the factual information out there. I think I went off topic. What was
it? Well, the topic is when you're at a major incident,
mm-hmm.
okay, in this case we're talking about a shooting, if you're relying on a PIO or the officials to give you information, what as a journalist are you doing in the meantime? I know you're not just standing there waiting for that press conference
sure.
to happen.
Sure. Well, you're talking to witnesses, you're talking to people who were there, and that's why sometimes you have trouble, because you get the witnesses' story that the media puts out, which isn't always true. So that's a dangerous kind of line we walk. But you're talking to witnesses, you're talking to neighbors, getting information you can that way as well. So, and sometimes it usually lines up. But
and Doug, I know the Times News is very active on social media these days. So talk to me about what the parameters are for what you put on social media versus what you might put online or in the newspaper. Are they any different?
They're not any different. You know, the urge is to react right now. You know, everyone is looking to us to you know, we want to know what's happening right now, but you have to confirm it. Every staffer we have, they all have Twitter accounts. They all know if you can't confirm it, you can't post it. And, you know, in a situation like what's going on in Oregon, what happened in Howard County, you know, a news organization like ours is saturating the scene with reporters. You know, some are sitting on people like Dan, some are finding the chief, some are finding, you know, officers who are, they know and will give them some context. They can't quote those folks, but they can lead us to, you know, angles on the story that is unfolding in front of them. We also have people who are running down witnesses, because you want to hear what are they seeing, what are they hearing. And we have folks who are back in the newsroom who are scanning social media. There are a couple sites here who do all the police reports as they happen. Erie Alerts is one of them. You know, you're checking that, but that in itself is not completely reliable. You're looking at individuals and hashtags, like Dan says, and trying to find clues to what's unfolding. But the responsible thing is, before we post it, is to know that what we're posting is the best obtainable version of the truth at that moment.
In an incident like that is happening right now, at what point does a prosecutor get involved? Would they be at a crime scene like that, Craig?
Typically not. Prosecutors generally do not, I'm not saying they never do, but generally do not go to crime scenes. They don't go to the execution of search warrants and things like that. And one of the biggest reasons is you would not want to be a witness in your own case. If you're going to prosecute the case, you can't, you know, obviously be a witness in the case as well. So. But the prosecutor would be involved, you know, right away in the event that you need to, you know, get a search warrant for the, you know, the suspect's house or car or you know, Facebook account and things like that. I do want to mention that I think it's an interesting angle to consider on the sort of mass random shooting incidents, is that, and I don't know anything about the Oregon case, so, mm-hmm. you know, it may not be consistent with this, but It seems like a lot of the people that engage in that type of criminal behavior, they would rather be notorious than anonymous. So they're doing things that are terrible, but they essentially want to get attention, and they go down, you know, in the process they're, you know, oftentimes killed as well. You know, but they're trying to, in a sense, get their name out there and get attention. And as a result of the media attention that's given to them, they essentially achieve their purpose. And I'm not suggesting that the media not cover those types of events. I really don't think that there's a real solution. I mean, they're certainly newsworthy, and they need to be covered in the manner that they are. But I think we have to understand that I do think a lot of the people that engage in that type of activity are achieving their goal because of the media response that their terrible act generates.
It's interesting because as I read some of the news accounts of the incident today, there apparently was some social media posts allegedly from the shooter who talked about feeling so insignificant in their life and how this act may have changed that for them. Elvidge, anything from your perspective that, you know, as both a public defender and a prosecutor,
I remember when I was in the district attorney's office, that was during the time of the tragic shooting involving Andrew Wirst. Mm-hmm. And as we were discussing, or as the discussion was taking place earlier, and people were recalling how the national media just sort of descended upon our community, it would have been very easy for our office at that time. And I'm not just, coating Dr. Connie with a lot of sugar up there, but I'll tell you something. He showed a lot of intestinal fortitude and discipline. He didn't take the bait. And there were a lot of national news agencies that were calling the office constantly, wanted interviews, and he didn't give them. And, and I think it's that kind of restraint that I think is missing because, let's face it, you guys are addictive. You know, when the cameras show up, it's an opportunity to get your name out there. It's an opportunity to develop a reputation, especially if you're a young attorney and you're trying to make a name for yourself. And, you know, because certainly people remember those cases, and those cases create opportunities for, maybe future political positions. So, I think for me, from a professional standpoint, I think it's important, especially for some of our students here who may want to work in those positions, you know, you've got to understand that there's a time to pull back and to exercise some discipline, because real people are being impacted by the things that you say, the statements that you make, and unfortunately, you say the wrong thing, it can really compromise justice being served correctly.
I think we have all agreed over dinner tonight that the national media, when they come to town, are a little bit more demanding, perhaps, than the folks that you deal with on a day-to-day basis. Would that be right, Dan?
Yep. On the local level, I would work a lot with Doug and Emily, and we would build a relationship talking about what's going on. They can call any time of day and say, hey, this is what I'm hearing on the scanner, or I got a tip on this. Can you give me anything on it? And like she said, it's true. If she calls, a bigger agency like Harrisburg and say, hey, can you give me something? They're going to be a little bit more holding back and not sharing. If she called me and said, hey, Dan, can you share this information with me? I'm trying to figure this out. I'd give her a little bit more information. You know, I'd say, okay, let me take some time. Let me look it up and see what I've got. And give her a call back and say, hey, you know what? That is kind of interesting. Here's what I've got so far. Give me a little bit more time and see where we're at with it. With that relationship, I know for a fact I could say, hey, don't run with it yet for a second. Just let me work on some magic on here, and I'll get back to you. And she'd be able to hold back. With the bigger agencies, you're kind of going, all right, CNN, hold on for 1 second. Fox News, hold on 1 second. That doesn't work. They want to get their information. They want it now. They don't care about the relationship. When they leave, my relationship with these guys could go sour because the fact that they've ruined me so bad that I don't care what Emily and Doug are going to say to me. I'm going to be like, you know what? I'm sorry. Right now I've got a sour taste in my mouth, and I just don't want to chat with you at the moment. For the most part, that doesn't really happen only because I know them, they know me, and I know it's not them. It's the other people. But once they leave, it's true. They have put a huge impact on people, and it's not just the community. It's my officers. My officers are going to be saying, you know what? Don't talk to them because they misquoted me. Or they gave wrong information.
and it's hurt us badly. So it's my job to be the neutral party of, okay, well, yes, but you got to look at where they're coming from. So my personal feelings towards media really gets pushed back a lot because I have to look at it from their perspective as much as it is from mine.
If you get phone calls from Emily or you get a phone call from Anderson Cooper, are you more likely to answer his questions than you would Emily because she's a local reporter and you've got a national reporter, or vice versa, a local affiliate versus, you know, again, somebody from the network calling?
You know,
is there any policy in regards to that?
There's not so much a policy. It's more of professional courtesy. You don't want to burn a bridge with Emily, who I'm going to see on a daily basis, versus Anderson Cooper, who I may see once every 6 years, which I'm still waiting for a phone call from him. But but no, I mean, there's not really that. It's a professional courtesy between the local and the police department. I mean, the great thing is, it may not be a big fish to her. So, for example, like I work with George on our Police Explorer program. I may have a fundraiser coming up, and George may go, Dan, I want you to promote this. Can you? Well, if I go to Fox News and go, hey, can you put this on the banner right there across the floor right there and say, Montgomery County Police Explorers is having a silent auction, they're going to be like, yeah, no, go pound sand.
That's right.
I can go to Emily and say, hey, Emily, you know, I've got this event. It's going to be great. The kids are going to raise a lot of money. The kids are going to be doing this. Could you put that out there? Chances are Emily might go, you know what? Absolutely. You've helped me out. You scratched my back. I'm going to help you and put this out there. It may not make national coverage like it would on Fox News, but it's going to make it's going to hit where I want to hit people at, and that's where I'm going to have to work with, you know. So it's not so much, you know, like I said, Anderson Cooper's a great guy, but he's not knocking on my door all the time.
Gotcha.
Plus that goes to the trust thing, you know. You don't trust. You can tell me something off the record or give me a little tidbit for me to perhaps get a better story, or maybe I should talk to this person over there that you might not talk to Cooper, because what's he going to do with that information? You know, is he going to put it out too early or throw you under the bus or something along those lines? So it really goes back to that trust too.
Yeah, what we're talking about here are relationships. Mm-hmm. You know, and the better you manage those relationships, you know, when the moment comes, the crisis comes, you know, the greater odds that you're going to get the call back first. You know, and or at least the time and the courtesy. You know, and my experience is that, you know, law enforcement understands the role that we play and the job we have to do just as we understand theirs. You know, there are boundaries and there are relationships. We're not friends and buddy-buddy, but there is the give and take. You know, we run the most wanted every week because it's a service. You know, it's part of, you know, part of the give and take between us and them. And, you know, in the end, we're all talking about community, but it's managing those relationships is a key part. And that's something that the national media just, they don't have the time to do it. They don't have the need to do it either. They parachute in, they get what they need, and they bail out to the next thing. And people like us and Emily and Lou, we get to clean up the pieces.
Mm-hmm. George?
The cleanup pieces extend far beyond that, I think. And the triad of police, community, and media, and I think with the national media, and the world that we live in of fast food and instantaneous information, I think people forget the impact it has far-reaching. And from my perspective, I start looking at how is this going to affect my young adults, because people forget about them because they're the ones watching this and they're forming opinions, and now they have questions, and they're going to be the ones who are voting later on, and they're going to be the ones who are in these jobs later on. How is that affecting them? So if we go down this path of giving out misinformation or bad information because we don't have the relationships, now we got a whole generation of mistrust among everybody. They don't, you know, we don't trust the media, the kids don't trust the police, and then the community services officer, community outreach officer, whoever, we got to go out and talk to our students and say, hey, this is not what's going on. This is not how the police are. This is not how the media is. This is not how we operate. You get this one, you know, piece of bad information, And it's way far reaching than just the police officers on the street and the media who are there. It goes way beyond it because there's just so many people impacted by it. How do you regain something that's been so damaged when information is put out there and it's damaging lives and it's damaging communities? You don't believe me? Go talk to those people in Ferguson.
Gotcha. Well, speaking of Ferguson, today's Oregon's day in the spotlight, but, you know, many other communities have been rocked by violence of some sort, whether it's other mass shootings, killings that happen, or it's been officer-involved shootings that have resulted in death, whether it's, you know, Michael Brown in Ferguson or Tamir Rice in Cleveland or Walter Scott in, you know, South Carolina, Freddie Gray in Baltimore. And I don't want to debate the merits of each one of those incidents because we'd be here all night, but instead I'd like the panelists to really talk about their reaction to the police and news media's handling of those cases, because some of them have been disasters and others not so much. But, maybe, Craig, just give us some thoughts that you have about how the authorities and how the media, handled themselves in any case that comes to mind for you.
Well, any of those high-profile cases, I think we all have to remember that no matter how good of a job the media does, it's almost always just part of the story until, you know, maybe there's a trial. And even after a trial, sometimes the public's never going to know everything that occurred. So to jump to conclusions, some of which are, very, meaningful conclusions without appreciating and having the modesty to know that you really don't know. If it's not your case and if you weren't there, you didn't get, you haven't collected the evidence, you haven't reviewed the discovery in the case, from the defense side, I'm not saying you shouldn't reach, an opinion, but what I am saying is you shouldn't reach such a strong opinion that you sort of induce from that in a way that stains the entire criminal justice system. I think there's far too much, and I think I'm using the right word, induction from one incident to all incidents, then there should be much more deduction, that there's, there are far too many good police officers and good community members to conclude that one particular incident is how the police behave, in a larger scale, or that one particular incident is how, a 19-year-old, person from that community would behave. It's just, we want to reach that broad conclusion, and many times we shouldn't reach such a broad conclusion.
Are you suggesting that after two or three Facebook posts, we're not going to know everything about that incident or an hour of Fox News?
It's true. I mean, we want to, and I'm not blaming people. I mean, I'm a prosecutor. I know that I want to reach a conclusion about a certain case. But I know that for my own cases that have been reported on, you're just not going to know as much as the people who actually were involved in that case, so you should not reach such a strong conclusion. But I think that that's what our tendency is, and perhaps it's always been a human tendency to sort of want to talk beyond your level of knowledge, but I just think we shouldn't reach such broad, strong conclusions, and we should appreciate that you really don't know everything about a case if you're not directly involved in it.
So with human nature the way it is, and with the news media doing what it does, how does that help or hinder your efforts as a prosecutor when it's time to finally take that mess to court?
If you're just focusing on just that one case, if it's high profile enough, it obviously could affect your jury pool. But I think that the more important effect that it has is on the way the public views what you do as a law enforcement officer in general. We have, and I know I've mentioned this earlier tonight, but we need to make sure that the public thinks it can have trust in what we do, that we're not a bunch of idiots, we're not liars, we're not fools. And I think that, to some extent, there's been a perception from some of these incidents that's what we are. And it's probably partly because we don't, you know, really share as much information about what we do, so we're open to attacks that just aren't true.
Mm-hmm. Emily, what's your take on how the news media, how law enforcement has handled, you know, these major incidents in a world of 24-hour news cycle and constant live coverage when something big happens?
Sure. Well, I guess comparing Ferguson incident and the Boston incident, Baltimore. But the Ferguson, national media came in, I feel like they were, my percentage goes up every time I think about it, but probably like 90% responsible for the damage left behind. They kind of showed up and lit little fires and threw gasoline on them and then just left. Reported on things before they knew the facts. Much of the information that initially came out from that, as we know, turned out to be untrue. So is that the media's fault, or is that the law enforcement's fault for not giving the media the information right off the bat? And then the Baltimore thing, I feel when that happened, when that incident happened, that they came out right off the bat, said this is what's going on, this is what, I feel like they were more on top of it when that happened. I mean, the outcome was still, you had rioting and people upset, but I feel like when there's that transparency, I had an incident one time where there was a, locally, Erie police were interviewing a suspect. The detective went out of the room to do something, and the suspect opened the door and went out the front door of City Hall and left. And so I interviewed the chief, and I'm like, well, what, you know, what, how did this, well, the door locked from the inside. Well, what are you going to do? We're going to fix it. It's like, well, wait, there's nowhere else for me to go with that story. You know, he's honest. He came out, and he said, you know, the door wasn't, it locked from the outside, not the inside. The guy walked out of the City Hall, and we're going to fix it. So if you don't, if you're transparent, if you come out from the get-go, give the information you can, I think that helps, you know, ward off some of the false information and some of the negative effects that can happen by reporting false information.
Anybody else have a strong opinion on how the media or law enforcement has handled any of these incidents before we move on?
I don't know if it's a strong thing, but I think we should not hit the send button while we're emotionally charged. And I say that because all these incidents, everybody is tense, everybody's emotional, and I don't care who you are. There's a lot of chaos going on. And I think everybody needs to take a deep breath, step back, and go, okay, what's right, what's not? Is that possible? Yeah, sometimes not. But when you start talking and everybody's emotionally charged, you're going to get stuff and you're going to hear things that probably, you know, sometimes you go, man, I wish I didn't say that. Or, man, that was not a good look. So I just think you need to step back before you hit the send button and emotionally de-escalate a little bit before we get into sending out information.
You know, chaos is the right word there. Mm-hmm. You know, in those situations, everything is splintering into pieces. And, you know, in some cases, the police are adding to the problem by not talking. In some cases, some of the reporters who are rushing to the crowds are inciting it by turning on the cameras or turning on the microphones, and it's in those situations it's hard to know, you know, what's the right thing to do. You can't look away. You know, you're, as journalists, you know, we're witnesses to what's going on. And there's an obligation to report what's going on. But what you saw in some of these cases was something beyond reporting, you know. And then there's the whole issue and the whole presentation of the citizen journalists, the people who are capturing parts of an event and putting them out, and people are interpreting that as the whole story. And, you know, in many cases, that's been proven to be not the whole story. And yet, the police department, as they're, you know, trying to sort through the details, are not saying anything that would actually lower the temperature on this. It becomes, in essence, a feeding frenzy.
And that takes me to our next area of discussion, and that is, you know, just the fact today that there are cameras everywhere, and they seem to catch everything. And so many of these major incidents that we've seen reported on television The flames have been fanned by the fact that there is video, and the video is on television relatively quick. And it may be everything that happened. It may be a snippet of what happened, as Doug alluded to. And really, you know, the question is there value in the social media phenomena of everybody having a camera in their pocket and dashboard cameras in police cars? And it leads us to the question of body cameras on police officers. Let's talk about this video. And is it valuable in our role in the news media to help tell a story? Is it valuable to law enforcement to help figure out what happened or what didn't happen? And how does all of this affect you know, the process when it comes to trial time? Is the fact that all this video has been out there and everybody's seen bits and pieces of it, is that helpful or harmful? So who wants to start with that one? George?
That's like a loaded question there.
Dan, do you want to start?
You know, I like the idea when everyone has a camera, everybody becomes, you know, a reporter of some sort. What I like about it, though, is, for example, like I monitor our Twitter page and I monitor our Facebook page. I get a lot of people who send me pictures and videos of what they see going around their community. I've got vehicles that are parked illegally. I've got people who find drug paraphernalia in their neighborhood near parks. I've got people who see police cars, you know, five police cars deep, and it's one vehicle that's been stopped and one vehicle and one occupant. And they're asking me, is this normal? You know, why are there five police cars and one person? Don't you guys have something better else to do? I think when they send those to me, it gives me the opportunity to educate. And I think that's what a lot of it is we have to educate each other on what police practices are, what police policies are, and how we enforce it. So with that sending stuff to me, it gives me a little bit of time to look at it and figure out what the actual story is behind it and then respond to them. That's something we didn't have before. It used to be I'd have to call our dispatch center, find a police officer to talk to, or go to the police station behind a, you know, bullet-resistant glass and ask that question, hey, I saw a police car parked in a fire lane, and he was in McDonald's the whole time. Why was that? Now, instead, they're able to send it to me, and I can respond to that. The other problem also with that is they send it directly to the media, and they say, hey, look, this officer here grabbed this guy, tased him, and what are you going to do about it? Because I think that was excessive force. Well, the person at times will admit that, look, I didn't get the whole thing. I just saw a bit of it, but I recorded it. But I sent it to media, and you know, they hit the head on it. They want their 5 minutes of fame. I want to be able to say, that's what I saw, and that's what I submitted. Because in 2 weeks, I might be the next, you know, Oprah, the next Anderson Cooper. You know, a lot of the times, because we have that trust with the media, they'll send that to me a lot of times beforehand and say, hey, we got this video. What do you know about it? You know, we're going to release it. I'm going to give you probably till another hour and a half to figure out what you want to do. With that little bit amount of time, I'm able to come up with a response to it and at least start looking into it. And then there are days when they just go, yeah, FYI, I'm releasing this on now. Figure out what you're going to say, because in 20 minutes I'll be down at the station to interview you live on TV. Okay.
Can I answer that question?
Well, that was kind of like a loaded question
I think,
there.
Yeah, but I guess I would follow up saying, if given your druthers and you had that video or the ability to stop the media from having that video, would you do that?
You know, I don't ever want to stop the media from having it, because I don't want to put that censorship on them. You know, I believe, and our department believes in transparency. You know, share as much information as you can. Like I said, I want to educate everybody on what we do as police, because as long as you know what we're doing and why we do it, it puts a lot of, okay, this is why, and I feel a little bit more comfortable with it. If I hold back and say, hey, don't release that video, then there kind of brings up that, you know, unconscious thought of, ooh, he's hiding something. There's something more there. And then the next day I've got 60 Freedom of Information Act requests saying, can you tell me about every you know, use of force assault you've had? Can you tell me every time an officer deployed a taser? Can you tell me every time an officer has been investigated for, you know, something? So I think with having that relationship of them saying, hey, this is the video I have, we're going to share it, but we're going to share your side of the story. It helps a little bit more. It shows that we are a partnership, but it shows that we have nothing to hide. A lot of times, you know,
unfortunately, we don't get that opportunity. We're judged real quick, you know, while we're sitting here as to what we did wrong before we have a chance to explain it.
Prosecutors, what do you guys think about that video and whether it's helpful to your case, it could be harmful, and whether or not the news media should have it?
Well, it definitely can be helpful. And, you know, I think that I generally support the use of, like, body cameras. But it can also hurt, and it can hurt for this reason. And I go back to the dash camera video scenarios. I think that if you do have a traffic stop, most people in the public expect that there, you know, is dash camera video of the traffic stop. Most patrol cars do have a dash camera, but a lot of times it is not working because the technology is not the greatest sometimes, and it takes a lot to repair them. The problem is if you're a police officer and you had you have a dash camera video of a traffic stop, or you were wearing a body camera and it malfunctioned, now all of a sudden it looks like you're hiding something, because the public is going to expect that, well, you know, why isn't there video of this? I mean, it's great when you have the video, and I generally support it. I think in this climate at times, police officers, if for no other reason, need body camera video to protect themselves from sometimes false claims that they did something that they didn't do. But I think we have to realize, as a prosecutor, you're going to, the more body cameras there are, the more times a body camera is going to malfunction. And now you're going to have a police officer trying to convince a jury that an event occurred a certain way, and will also have to explain why they don't have video of it. And that could be, you know, a problem. It doesn't mean, you know, in the end, it's probably still a good thing to have body cameras, but that's a complicating factor.
Well, I can tell you, those of us in the TV business understand technical difficulties intimately. I know in Erie we reported a story, I think it was earlier this week. No, it was last week. And some video came into play that was valuable for the station Emily works at, and that's the Emea Soup Kitchen fire. You followed that up with some video you had that somebody shot of actually the suspect at the fire scene. You want to talk about that and what that added to the story and how that was beneficial?
Well, there was a witness that was at the scene, and he had his cell phone, and he was recording the fire. He was there before the fire department arrived or police, and the suspect was standing there going, "Oh, my gosh, look at the fire. I think it must be electrical." So he's recording this all on video, and we eventually, one of our reporters contacted him through Facebook and did an interview with him, and he told the story about the fire, and it's compelling video. The fire was there before firefighters got there, obviously, and the fact that he had the suspect on camera made an interesting story for sure. So we often... everybody's a journalist now, really, it seems. You know, anybody who has a cell phone or any sort of device is a journalist. They put it up on Facebook, and a lot of times it's there before we're on air or before we get there. So we often reach out to others, you know, to citizens, to use their video, because it makes for a good story.
Gotcha. Doug, your thoughts on what you see on television or what you're able to post online?
I saw that video online as well, you know, and nowadays everyone really is a reporter. You know, they're all eyewitnesses. You know, being able to engage the audience and show what's really, you know, what was happening. I mean, that was, you know, throughout history, the eyewitness stories are always the stories that people appreciate most, and now that you can have almost instant access to a news event as it's unfolding, you know, is priceless in a way. All of our reporters are, you know, carry iPhones that the company provides, and that is so that they can shoot video on the scene of spot news or interviews with police officers or any other source. and they can post those videos immediately to our website. You know, back in the day, you know, that was a, you had to wait for the next morning or you had to wait for the evening newscast to see what was happening if you weren't there yourself. Now you can see it within seconds. And in some cases, you can see it expertly produced within seconds. And that is a game changer in the industry. And it's a game changer in the relationship between the media and the police.
One of the things that puts pressure on police departments is not having enough people to do everything that needs to be done. One of the things that puts pressure on newsrooms is not having enough people to keep and get everything done. You know, the news organizations are a business, and we need to make a profit for our owners and shareholders. And so it seems more and more often staffs are getting smaller, and yet we have more and more product that we do. I want to talk about, you know, what the downside is of this, I guess, lack of resources sometimes, and how that affects the media's ability to report. Probably at one time, the Times had more reporters than it does now. I don't know. I know our newsroom never had more reporters, but we've got way more product than we used to. When I started at the television station 35 years ago, we had a half an hour newscast at 6 and 11, Monday through Friday, and that was it. I mean, there was nothing else. And yet we've got so much more news is on all the time. Same thing, I'm sure, where Emily works. Sometimes we have what I consider drive-by reporting. You know, we talked about how the media comes in, national media, and they do their thing. They come in like gangbusters, and boom, they're gone. And yet locally, sometimes we don't have the ability anymore to develop those relationships. How is it with the police department where you are in terms of staffing? I know in the Erie Police Department, with all the crime and violence and shootings that have happened, there's been a lot of talk about the numbers of police officers on the street, and is there enough to adequately police? But, you know, those pressures really play on both the media and law enforcement. George?
Do more with less. I agree. We have a county of 1 million people. We have 1,200 officers. We probably are not adequately staffed now, because if you start looking at the attrition rate, there are a lot of us who are retiring. And I like to say that because I'm going to be one of those people very soon. So,
bravo.
So as people can retire faster than we can train officers to proficiently and effectively do the job. It takes an immense amount of training to get officers out there to do the job correctly. So yeah, it's affecting us. And so now you have this turnover and this training, this long training, that you don't have the time to get out and do proactive things like you would like to do, like build relationships in the community, like get out and meet, you know, the community leaders, get out and meet the store owners and the business owners. You don't have that luxury, because although we are trying to bring the numbers up to speed, we're not there yet, but the call for services are going up. So they're not dwindling. There's still enough work to go around. So we got more work and just not enough people to do it, just like you said.
And does that increase the scrutiny that perhaps police get in terms of the job they do and the results they bring from the news media and the public?
I think it can at times, because, again, we live in an instantaneous society. I call the police, I need you there right now. You know, and people are like, how come you didn't come faster? Well, they don't know that I got six calls stacked under me. And we have to prioritize calls depending on urgency. So, well, you know what? It took you an hour to get here to take a report for my lost wallet. Okay, well, I had a pediatric injury that probably took precedence over that. So, yeah, we kind of get the scrutiny and things like that.
Doug, how about from the media side in terms of resources? And
I think it's less an issue of resources than it is a function of time. Urgency, you know, you want to get that information out. You want to be first, you know, and You know, and that just collides with the facts sometimes. And so, you know, for us, our operation, we have some of our most experienced staffers working the police and court beats just because, you know, the tradition in journalism has always been to throw the new people out on spot news. You know, but in our place, it's the opposite of that, because you have to have people who have the relationships with the police officers, with the courthouse staff, you know, because when things are happening very quickly, they're the ones who are going to be able to filter that information most effective and deliver factual information to the public. You know, I think the bigger thing that happens is you get an incomplete report than an incorrect one. And that's on both sides of the equation. When the police don't have full information and they're trying to be good guys or good gals and saying this is what we have, and then you go with it and there's so much more to the story, that's the real error that you find today.
I've got many more questions, but I wanted to make some time, leave some time, at least the last quarter hour or so, for all of you to see if you had things on your mind, maybe before you came here tonight, or that was stimulated by the conversation with so many experts from the field of law enforcement and news media. If you have any questions, let's entertain a few from the audience here. Anybody have any? Yes.
Thank you. So the two officers that are on the panel, thank you for your service.
Look.
God bless. What I'd like you to address is the impact that political leaders have on what you do for your community. For instance, when you have the leader of the free world making a statement that the police acted stupidly, and it continues for a period of time, how do you address that?
First of all, I'm not going to get into the political agendas and opinion. And that doesn't have to be anybody. It doesn't have to be a political leader. It's anybody that impacts. Anytime something, especially in law enforcement, we are always under scrutiny. And it can come from anywhere. So if some officer, because let's be realistic, there are some officers who do some things that we go, that just set us back 10 years in law enforcement. All right. So now you have this officer or you have someone politically or otherwise say something, and now it reaches the news media, it affects from coast to coast. Because now here's that broad stroke. Well, they're all like that. So that makes it an uphill battle when I go out to the community and go, hey, how can I help you? And now you got this element of, well, we don't really trust you because of what people in, I don't know, other states have done, and you're just like them. Right? And I, sometimes I have to go, no, you don't know me, because once I take off this outfit, you know, I'm just a husband, a dad, you know, a goofball, you know, that, and that's what I pride myself on, really. But I'm just like that. But because we get painted like that because of the faults or the mistakes of some officers or the mistakes of what some people have their opinion to be, it just makes their job that much harder.
Thank you. Dan, any thoughts on that?
You know, it's like George mentioned earlier, a lot of us speak from frustration. You know, we hit that send button and we can't take it back. For where I work, my job, I work a lot with our chief of police, the executive staff, and the mayor and city council. On a continuous basis, they have a relationship with me where they can email me and say, hey, I want to know what's going on with this. What do you say? The same goes for the county council, which George works for. They have the same access to me as well. It doesn't make a difference which level of government I work for. They all have the same access. Because I know them a little bit better, and because I work with them on a more daily basis,
I think because of that relationship where they can ask the questions on the input on what happened, because I give that to them, it helps them a little bit more before they open their mouth and say anything. A lot of times they have said some things where I'm going, you know, I wish you didn't say that. But again, we're all human beings, and I'm not going to always have time to consult with them on their comments, and they're not going to have all the time to consult with me. You know, it's just, I think a lot of times we speak from that emotional spot, and we like to stick to our script, like Lee said, you know, you stick to your script, and then sometimes you go off, and, you know, next thing after you went off that script, you're like, ooh, how do I retract back to it? But I think, again, it comes down to just a relationship, you know. I know who you're talking about, and I'm not going to comment on him. but, on the local, more local level, it's, I'm able to just, like I said, talk to them a little bit more, give them more insight on that concern they have, and kind of prep them on what they could say or not say. But at times I have had it where I'm, like, scratching my head just going, oh, my goodness.
Can I add one more thing to that?
No, you can't.
Yeah, because I know you.
I'm going to need you to stay on your side of the table. Now you made me forget what I was going to say. I'll come back to it. See, that's why I don't work with him.
Other questions? I see a hand over there. I don't know that I totally heard or understood your question. Could you restate that again?
I meant to say that your opinion on big technology might be interfering people's invasion of privacy, and if see if there is recent methods to may counteract that.
How is technology an issue of invasion of privacy, and how do you protect yourself?
I mean, when I'm trying to process what you just said, I mean, when I think about just the magnitude and the utility of Facebook and Twitter and Instagram, hey, once you set it off, there is no privacy anymore. You know, a lot of the invasion of privacy, a lot of that's self-induced. You know, when you put your business out there, you can't claim a reasonable expectation of privacy. That's shot. So, you know, and it, for me, it just goes back to understanding what degree of self-control and discipline does an individual want to exercise to be able to later claim, look, I'm choosing to exercise some privacy in how I decide to carry out my day-to-day affairs. But once you put it out there for the world to see, you forfeit that. You know, so I hope I've addressed your question or your comment satisfactorily.
One of the things about that also is I think there's some misunderstandings and probably myths about what law enforcement is able to acquire. I think there's probably some misunderstandings about this like great technology that we supposedly have, and that you know, there's been reporting on the use of cell site simulators as if we've been using them in federal law enforcement to intercept people's phone calls and to get you know, all of this metadata and beyond metadata actually to content. And I mean, I've actually even seen a story within the last 18 months that stated that the FBI's position on the use of cell site simulators is that they can intercept content without of telephone calls without legal process, without a wiretap authorization. That hasn't been the FBI's position since 1965. But there's so much misinformation out there about what we do. I think it's fed partially by television shows such as, you know, I won't name them all, but if we could do half the things they could do on TV, we'd be fantastic, but we can't. And then there's media reports such as like the Patriot Act, and it's just, some of it's true and some of it is just flat out false. And there's a lot of misinformation out there.
Question here.
Yes. This is a question for reporters. As far as, I noticed that majority of the time, and my name is Virgil McClendon, by the way, I know that majority of the time when you're watching the news,
they like to say a lot of things about how officers may not, you know, jump out of situations the correct way because it just happens. So it's like a reaction, you just have to get it done. As far as the reporters are concerned, you know, they say that, you know, y'all just report the information, y'all learn about the information, you know, report it on the news channel. And as far as myself, I may one day probably go into that as a career path. And I wanted to know, like, if a situation were to occur and it just happened and you had to immediately, you know, get to it, get your job done, you had to get there, how do you go about the situation? Because do you, my question is there ever a moment where you're thinking in the back of your mind, okay, I have to report this the right way so whoever watching this doesn't think that, you know, I'm one-sided or this happened this way when it really doesn't, like, how, what goes through your mind? And then after you figure out how you want to do it, how do you go about it when you're online, national television, and it's just happening at that moment?
Well, I think it goes back to, like Doug mentioned earlier, just confirming your facts. I would never go on with the story, no matter what, with unconfirmed facts. And that kind of, an example, and it goes back to, I retract my statement earlier where I said I get along with all local police departments and we have a great relationship.
Now that you've thought about
yeah,
it.
Now that I've thought about it. But there was an incident where a suspect had, it was a domestic incident in a small Crawford County town. And the husband was in the car with the wife. He slit her throat, stabbed her several times, and then ran in the woods. Mind you, this was Conneautville, a place where everybody, it's very...
everybody knows everybody.
Everybody knows everybody. There's a lot of hunters. Everybody's got guns in their house. And you've got a madman who just slit his girlfriend, I think it was his girlfriend's throat, stabbed her and killed her. So we got a tip. Because I had a friend who lived there, and she said, hey, there's something going on. There's cops all the way up the road. So, you know, we called the agents. Hey, what's going on? Nothing. They wouldn't tell us anything. And so this was kind of where the communication and where, you know, you can be adversaries, because it's like, here you've got a man running around in the woods with a knife who just stabbed his girlfriend, and you are not telling the media what's going on so we can say what's going on. So I ended up being off that night. So another journalist posted something on Facebook right away and was like, husband kills wife, da, da, da. And the information wasn't confirmed from police. It was just neighborhood gossip. You know, I heard, you know, it was so-and-so killed his girlfriend. And part of the Facebook post ended up being incorrect. So it started kind of an argument or a conversation, I guess, at work. When do you use that Facebook to get this information out to tell the public, like, hey, if you're in Conneautville, lock your doors, know that there's something going on, and be alert, get that information out there, or getting the correct information, because the police aren't giving it to you. They would not tell us squat. So it's kind of, that's where the relationship works out, and that's where sometimes the relationship doesn't work, is it's our job to get the message out there. We want to get it to as correct as possible, but perhaps maybe we decided that the Facebook post should have been phrased a different way.
I think that
answered your question, Virgil.
That incident that she talks about was, I learned later, a complete breakdown in the state police's ability to communicate, first of all, to their PIO officer, who was never called, you know, the news media, instead of saying that there is something going on but we can't tell you much, they literally said there was nothing going on, and yet all over social media were these reports and pictures and everything else of all this activity going on. So I think, you know, and Doug might agree, social media is a great way to find something out, but just like anything else you find out, you've got to vet it and confirm it. It used to be in the old days somebody might call you. These days, they just post something on Facebook. And that just serves as a lead for those of us in the news media. Doug, any other thoughts on it?
It's just another tool, you know, and you have to regard it as such. And you can't take anything you see on Facebook as
fact.
Truth.
Yeah.
In fact, you know, it could lead you to that. And... you know, just, you know, and in that situation, the PIO was out of the loop, and everything was happening around him, and he did not know it. And it wasn't until you had people actually there talking to the officers on the scene you know, that you actually learned what was going on. You know, it was a chaotic situation.
Tony, how are we on time?
I think we may have time for one more quick question.
One more quick question? Gentleman in the red shirt.
My question is, I'm looking at this flyer, and there's a lot of words about complicated, critical, heated adversaries, complicated. And the point of this panel is to come to common ground. But while you guys are up there, it seems like you're already on common ground. You're agreeing about things at dinner, scratching each other's back. Courtesy, where is the conflict and where is the heated adversaries? And who is challenging the local power structure pool that we have locally? Who is really going at the issues locally? Because I see, I mean, I'm in the streets and I'm all over the place and I see a lot of glossing over of things in here.
I think this recent incident was just an example of issues between the news media and authorities. To expand that further, Doug, you want to?
Yeah. Conflict, you know, where that happens is usually in the heat of, you know, situations.
Right.
It's situational and it's that natural tension between our need to try to get information and police and law enforcement, their need to figure it out and figure out how they want to dole it out. That is a natural tension that exists every single day. The overarching relationship is not adversarial, at least not between my news organization and local law enforcement. And by local, I mean the Erie Police Department, the Edinboro Police Department, State Police. I mean, we talk to these folks. We know them. They know us. Yeah, you know, we don't play golf together, but, you know, we understand the roles that that we each have. And generally, when there have been issues, you know, I'll go down and see the chief, and we'll talk through those issues, but there's usually not a systemic us versus them situation.
Hey, I've witnessed that conflict. And oftentimes that conflict is a product of someone pushing their own individual agenda. You know, having worked in Erie County Courthouse for a number of years and you get familiar with the culture, there is personnel within the courthouse that has a direct line to certain members of the media. And if that individual in the courthouse doesn't like another person within county government or another person within city government, I have certainly seen efforts by individuals who hold high positions in our county, who have attempted to utilize the media to create problems for other people who are performing functions or duties associated with the position that they hold. So the agendas do exist. Let's not kid ourselves. But I think it's very important for those of us who are in a professional capacity, you got to rise above them, and sometimes you just got to call people into account. And oftentimes that doesn't always happen as often as it should. So I hope I've given you some confidence.
Yeah, yeah. All right. I appreciate it.
Okay.
And just to conclude, I think in referring to what you have in your hand here, I've got to give kudos to the Public Relations Student Society of America members who probably put this together, because they sure did sell the sizzle of this event tonight, didn't they? And I think what you might have learned here is that perhaps there isn't quite as much of a conflict between news media and authorities in law enforcement as you might think because of what you see in the national media. Yeah, sure can.
In reference to your concern about the conflict between us, I think with all of us here talking, we're all on the local level. We're discussing our relationships and how we're able to communicate a little bit with one another and be able to resolve a lot of the issues. Mm-hmm. On the police side, when we see a lot of the conflict, it's not so much these guys here. It's we all have a job. Media has a job to do, and that is to sell. So they're going to put in there sometimes those headlines that make us just cringe, okay? And it's not so much the fact that I'm going to call
right on News 4 or right there on national news and be like, that is ridiculous, that's not what's going on. They got to sell that two-second segment real quick to get you interested in that news story. What I'll end up doing is calling Doug or calling Emily and say, hey, guys, what's going on with this? Mm-hmm. That's not what happened. You know it's not what happened. And they're going to tell me, yeah, you know what, you're right. That's just what they threw out there real quick to show to the public to get them to watch that news story, and then we're going to go with it. Sadly, a lot of the adversity we have on the police department is just it's the titles that are put out there, you know, the headlines. Mm-hmm. You know, that's what makes us go, okay, I don't trust the media, I dislike the media and everything else, but it's behind the doors that nobody else sees. And that's this communication we have here of, that's not right, you got to fix it. Whether or not we see it right in the front like we want, you know, we may see it, as we always say, in the back of page A, B, column 4, right in a small print. Oh, sorry, here's the updated correction. We don't get to see it as glamorized as everybody else does.
Inflammatory nature of those kind of comments. I mean, I see a lot of it is happening, like, with the community. And is it a hindrance with regard to the police and the community? Because when they talk about, you know, I hear a lot about Erie's East Side. Mm-hmm. After coming back here, after living in Baltimore and living in Los Angeles, to come to my hometown, and to hear, like, Erie's East Side, you know, this tragic thing, and sometimes it was a pop gun. You know what I mean? But you hear these headlines, and it doesn't, I mean, to me, it seems like it's a trap. I don't know if does the media really understand the impact that has, like even on a GE or the people that come here, or students that come here, to almost like demonize like a section of the city?
I can tell you on that point that over a year ago, because of comments like that and after careful consideration, we have eliminated the use of Erie's East Side or West Side in any of our reporting. There's an incident, we'll give you the address. You figure it out if it's the East Side or West Side. But we do not say another shooting on Erie's East Side or, you know, another home invasion on the Lower East Side because of the connotations that brought with us. We do report the address because, you know, we are going to tell you where things happen because if it's your neighborhood, you want to know about it. But there are connotations with phrases like that, so we've stopped using them, okay? Complete outright ban in our newsroom, you know, because of things like that. So, well, last question, and that was it. And again, great job in selling the sizzle of tonight's event. We hope it was informative, and I thank all of my media and law enforcement partners for being here tonight and for the opportunity to bring this to you this evening. Thank you.